Hey, Peter here with my FSHD. So I understand there's some confusion out there with some people when you get your research test results back from us that say FSHD 2 or FSHD 1 plus 2. And you say, well, wait a minute, there's FSHD 1 in my family, not 2. Or I already have a report that says FSHD 1. What is this FSHD 1 plus 2 or FSHD 2? And it's also come to my attention there's some misinformation or some just flat out wrong information floating around out there. Imagine that on the internet, wrong information. So anyway, I'm going to take a couple of minutes right here and clear it all on up for you. All right, so y'all remember that all forms of FSHD are linked to chromosome 4A. Okay, that's FSHD1, FSHD2, and that's because that's where the DUX4 gene that causes FSHD is located, right? It's located on chromosome 4Q, and it needs the A subtelomere to become properly expressed. And FSHD1 and 2 are both epigenetically linked to chromosome 4A. Okay, in the healthy situation, you have heavy methylation here, indicated by these black lollipops. And in FSHD1, you lose that methylation due to the contraction, as indicated by these yellow lollipops, indicate loss of methylation. And then in FSHD2, which does not have the contraction, you still have lost that methylation at the FSHD locus. So FSHD1 and 2 are linked epigenetically due to low DNA methylation at the FSHD locus. So genetically, you'll remember that FSHD1 is caused by a contraction of the D4Z4 repeat on chromosome 4A. Okay, right? So if you have between 1 and 10 D4Z4 repeat units combined with a 4QA subtelomere, you're genetically FSHD1, right? If you have more than 10 repeats, you are not genetically FSHD1. Okay, what does that mean? Well, these repeats are recognized by the cell as an off switch. Okay, so in healthy individuals with more than 10 repeats, both chromosomes, remember you have one chromosome 4 from mom and one from dad, both of them are recognized as these should be turned off. They are methylated and these become epigenetically silenced. In FSHD1, that is not recognized as a repetitive region. You do not have that off signal, and therefore these are unmethylated, and this allows for the DUX4 gene to be expressed. Okay, so that's FSHD1. So what about FSHD2? Well, FSHD2 does not have the contraction. Okay, FSHD2, you can still have more than 10 D4Z4 repeat units. Turns out there is a range. It's about 9 to 20 D4Z4 repeat units. But it's very important to have this second part, which is a mutation in a regulatory gene, most commonly the SMCHD1 gene. It's often referred to as the FSHD2 gene. Okay, so this is actually key for FSHD2. It's still associated with the chromosome 4 D4Z4 repeat units, but it's diegetic. You need the second mutation. Okay, and this actually gets to some of the wonky inheritance. So what happens? Well, again, healthy individuals, these repeats are recognized, and you have an off switch that says turn me off, and it becomes methylated. In FSHD2, you'd still recognize that, hey, these are repeats, these should be turned off, but what's broken is the cell's ability to turn the region off. Okay, so the signal is there, it's just the cell's not capable to turn this region off. So again, it's epigenetically on. You express the DUX4 gene in your skeletal muscle, and that leads to FSHD. Okay, so how is this done? Well, that's due to this mutation in this SMCHD1 gene. So this is a regulatory protein that is an epigenetic repressor of the D4Z4 region. It is necessary for keeping the DUX4 gene off. Okay, so in healthy individuals, you recognize this should be methylated, this should be turned off, and the SMCHD1 gene and its gene product, its protein, are very important in keeping this region off. Okay, what happens in FSHD2? Well, you have a mutation in the SMCHD1 gene. There's different types of mutations, and there's literally hundreds of mutations that can cause FSHD2, and it's a very large gene. And you can get some different things. You can get a truncated protein, you can have a functionally inactive protein or a dominant negative protein, or you can just have a deletion of the region and get haploinsufficiency, which means you have half as much protein as you need. And this actually has different effects on how the locus is regulated. But ultimately, what happens is the region is unmethylated and the DUX4 gene is on. Okay, but this is actually why it's called digenic, though, is because the first genic part, the first gene part, is the D4Z4 with a 4QA region, and the second genetic part is the SMCHD1 mutation. So there you have it. FSHD1 and FSHD2 both have epigenetic dysregulation of the 4QA region. In FSHD1, you break the signal, right? The signal that says turn me off is broken and it's unmethylated and DUX4 is expressed. In FSHD2, the signal is there, but the switch is broken. It says turn me off, but it can't be turned off because of mutations in the SMCHD1 gene, or there are some other FSHD2 genes. They're just very rare, DNMT3B, LRIF. But more commonly, it's about 80% of the time, it's SMCHD1 gene mutations, okay? So again, you have the same end result, epigenetic dysregulation of the locus, DUX4 expression, you just get there a different way, okay? So how does this affect testing or diagnostics? Well, 95% of people are considered with FSHD are FSHD1, okay? So first thing you're tested for, if you're lucky enough to get FSHD testing, is to be tested for FSHD1, okay? And if you come up positive for FSHD1, testing is done, right? So if you come up negative for FSHD1, typically, sometimes, actually we're learning, a lot of times you just assume you're FSHD2, which that's actually often not the case we're learning. But anyway, that's normally the only time you've had FSHD2 testing, is if you're negative for FSHD1. Virtually no one, although there are some of you out there, but most people that are positive for FSHD1 have never had FSHD2 testing, just because of cost, and well, people doing the testing don't know any better. So there is something, however, that we now know called FSHD1+2. And people assume this is very rare. Well, actually, again, nobody or very few people are tested for it. It's turning out not to be as rare as we think. What this is you have FSHD1, D4Z4 contraction, and mutations in the SMCHD1 gene. Okay, and this is came out a few years ago that FSHD2 gene is a modifier of severity. So we know there's a lot of variability in severity in the clinical presentation of FSHD within families. And a lot of that is dictated by epigenetics. But SMCHD1 is an epigenetic regulator. And so it's turning out that, you know, some people may have this contraction that gives them FSHD1, but they also have FSHD2. And these would be people that are typically more severe than one would expect for the deletion size. We know traditionally 1 to 3 repeat units is the more severe form. The 7 to 10 repeat units is very mild and often asymptomatic. If individuals are 7, 8, 9, 10 repeat units, yet relatively severe, it's a good chance you're FSHD1+2. So what about inheritance? Well, this actually is where it really matters as well. FSHD1 is inherited, it's passed on 50% of the time. Okay, if you have an FSHD1 mutation and there's no SMCHD1 mutation in your partner, then, you know, statistically, half the children would be FSHD1. Okay, but statistically you get the repeat unit. Okay, so what about FSHD2? Well, FSHD2, as we mentioned, is digenic, okay? And, you know, one of the regions that you need is the 4QA region. That's the first gene part. And the second part is SMCHD1, which is on chromosome 18, okay? So they're unlinked. So you can inherit one without inheriting the other, okay? So in FSHD1, you only need to inherit the deletion. In FSHD2, there are two things you need to inherit. Okay, you need to inherit an FSHD2 size D4Z4. And again, we mentioned that was between 9 and 20 repeat units. So, and the SMCHD1 mutation. So someone with FSHD2 already would have both of those. And someone without, would have, well, potentially neither. And then how does the inheritance go? Well, it would be less likely to inherit both. Only 25% of the time would this individual inherit both. 50% of the time you inherit the 16 repeat unit, and 50% of the time you inherit the SMCHD1 mutation. So that's actually the four possibilities you actually get down here. And yet this individual without FSHD or no clinical FSHD, so they could be carrier of the SMCHD1 mutation, right? They did not get a permissive an appropriate sized array, but they still have the FSHD2 mutation. So this person's essentially healthy in the family, but they're a carrier. And if they end up, you know, having children with someone who has no SMCH2 mutation, but the proper sized D4Z4 chromosome, like a 17 repeat unit, you can have two healthy people now have an FSHD2 child. So it appears in this case that it skipped a generation. Well, actually, you know, the SMCHD1 mutation did not skip the generation, so it really didn't genetically. It was the other part of the digenic requirement that skipped. It's just, and so these are the possibilities. So FSHD2 is going to be inherited somewhat differently. Okay, so you have these carriers of FSHD2, okay, in these families. Now, what about FSHD1+2? Okay, so FSHD1+2, you have FSHD1, no SMCHD mutation, you know, proper size. But again, you might have a second chromosome. You have two chromosome fours that has a permissive size allele. And so 50% of the time, individuals are going to get the FSHD1 mutation. And if you're have children with someone who has an SMCHD1 mutation, again, healthy carrier, with this healthy carrier, now you end up having somebody that could be, you could have FSHD1, not FSHD, not a carrier. Again, not a carrier. FSHD2, because you didn't get the FSHD1 deletion, but you got the permissive FSHD2 size chromosome and the SMCHD1 mutation, because 50% of the time that's going to be passed on. And then 25% of the time you're going to get both. Okay, FSHD1+2. So you have the FSHD1 sized mutation and the SMCHD1 mutation. And likely this individual is going to be more severe than this individual over here, especially for a 7 repeat unit mutation. Okay, so this is FSHD1+2. And again, you can see how the inheritance kind of goes. So what's FSHD1+2? It's actually turning out to be more common than we really realize, because clinical FSHD genetic testing tests for FSHD1 first, and if positive, no additional testing done. Now the testing, if you had your testing done in our lab, that's not the case. You test for both at the same time. FSHD testing does not exclude FSHD2. Okay? People say, oh, I'm FSHD1, I'm not FSHD2. Unless you've had specific FSHD2 testing, you don't know that you're not also FSHD2. Most people have no idea if they're FSHD1 or FSHD1+2. And if clinically affected with a small deletions, meaning 8 to 10 repeat units, I think there's a good chance that you're FSHD1+2. Not always, but you know, there's probably. So now if you get your results, if you've done the epigenetic testing that's promoted by MyFSHD and that is done by the Jones Lab at UNR, and your results say not FSHD, or if they say healthy, that means that FSHD1 and FSHD2 have both been excluded, okay? Because this testing tests for both and tests for both at the same time. Now, if the epigenetic testing results say FSHD1, then you're FSHD1 because the FSHD2 epigenetics have been excluded, okay? Now, again, remember, this is research testing. This is not a clinical diagnosis, but based on the results, you know, if it says not FSHD or healthy, that's solidly correct. If it says FSHD1, then it's clearly not FSHD2. Now, the rub is here when it says FSHD2, okay? So because of the nature of the testing, it tests for FSHD1 and FSHD2 at the same time. If someone is the first assay says FSHD or not FSHD, okay? So there's no question FSHD. But if it says FSHD2, you're either FSHD2 or FSHD1+2. If you've had prior genetic testing that has confirmed FSHD1 and our results say FSHD2, then you are very likely FSHD1+2. Okay, and so if FSHD1 is in your family, so I understand out there people kind of say that, well, our testing might not be accurate or giving the wrong result. Actually, it's more accurate.
So there you go. Like everything else FSHD, it gets a little bit complicated, right? You can be FSHD1, you can be FSHD2, you can be FSHD1+2. Therapeutically, it really is not going to matter. Therapies should be applicable to all three of these cases. Clinically, you know, there's a little bit more severity with the FSHD 1+2. So if you see wide range in severity going through your family, there's a possibility that, you know, some members are FSHD 1+2 in an FSHD 1 family. We really don't know the true prevalence of this because, well, after FSHD 1 testing, if you come back positive, no one looks for FSHD 2. Okay. So anyway, I hope this is clear. There's more information on the MyFSHD website. You're always welcome to drop me an email, give me a call, and I'd be happy to go over this with you in person, and just make sure that you don't have any questions, particularly if it's your report. Okay, so hope this is all clear, and I'll catch you later.